In the last class, we discussed about the Clausius statement of the second law of thermodynamics. As per Clausius statement of the second law of thermodynamics, it is impossible to construct a device which operating in a cycle will produce no effect other than the transfer of heat from a body at a lower temperature to a body at higher temperature without the aid of external work. Now let us discuss about the two devices. The first one is the refrigerator and second one is the heat pump. We have discussed about the refrigerator as well as heat pump in the last class. So once again, I am going to revise that part. Now, a refrigerating machine or a heat pumping machine. So what you can see here is, here we have the high temperature reservoir, here we have the low temperature reservoir, and here we have the refrigerator, and there is work input W into the refrigerator. And because of this work input W, the heat QL is transferred to the high temperature, and now the heat which is entering the high temperature is actually equal to QH, which is actually equal to W plus QL. So this you already know, and we know the value of the COP for the refrigerator will be equal to QL divided by W. So this is the definition of the COP of the refrigerating machine or a refrigerator. Now we would like to know that what is this circle actually. I mean to say that this is a refrigerator. So what all the components are there in a refrigerator, which are actually required for a for making a refrigerator to work actually. So here I have enlarged this circle here. Okay, I have enlarged this circle, and now you can see there are four components which are comprising the refrigerator. The first one is the evaporator. This is number one. Number one is actually evaporator. Number two, it is the compressor. Number three, it is the condenser, and number four, it is the expansion device. So basically there are four components. The first one is the evaporator, second is the compressor, third is the condenser, and fourth one is the expansion device, which are present in case of a refrigerator. And the same components will also be present in case of a heat pump or a heat pumping machine actually. Okay, so let us see. Once we enlarge this refrigerator, we are still seeing that this lower temperature, now this lower temperature is also existing here. We have only replaced these reservoirs by two bodies actually. We have a body A, which is at low temperature TL. That is basically the space in the refrigerator where we are cooling the products. So basically, these are the products which are actually at low temperature TL. We are maintaining these products at the low temperature. And from these products, we are taking out the heat QL, and this heat is going into the evaporator. Now what exactly is happening in the evaporator, that I will explain you later on. And then in the compressor, we are supplying the work WC, you can call it as. And then from after the compressor, we have the condenser. The refrigerant passes through the condenser, and after the condenser, it passes through the expansion device. So these are the four components which are there in case of the refrigerator. And one more thing that you would should know here is that in this particular case, this temperature TL is greater than TE. So it means that if low temperature is, if it is I will say minus 20 degrees Celsius, then this temperature has to be minus 25 degrees Celsius. Only then the heat transfer QL is possible if there is a temperature gradient. Similarly, if we have to transfer the heat from TC to TH, from TC to TH, the value of TC should be greater than TH. So it means if the value of TC is say 50 degrees Celsius, then the value of TH should be equal to 45 degrees Celsius. Only then the heat transfer is possible. Now, first of all, let us go to this part actually. Once again, it is the same diagram which I have shown you in the previous slide. So now I am going to explain about the various components here. Now you can see what is written here. We have the space or the products at TL. So here I have considered TL to be minus 10 degree Celsius. And let us say this evaporator is at minus 15 degree Celsius. Okay. So automatically the heat will flow from minus 10 to minus 15 because minus 15 is lower temperature and minus 10 is higher temperature. Minus 10 degree Celsius is greater than minus 15 degree Celsius. So automatically the heat will flow from QL to evaporator. Now what is actually happening in this particular case? We have in the evaporator liquid refrigerant which enters and absorbs heat and evaporates in the vapor. So basically at this particular point we have the refrigerant vapor and it takes away the latent heat during this process in the evaporator. And at this particular point the refrigerant vapor enters into the compressor here. This is the compressor. The compressor compresses this refrigerant to high temperature and pressure. The temperature here is so high that it is even higher than the ambient temperature. So when this refrigerant vapor, which is now in the superheated state at this particular point, you may not be knowing much about the superheated state, but let me tell you, it is somewhat similar to the gaseous state actually. Okay, so the gas, this refrigerant at this particular point is at a very high temperature and high pressure actually. So when it enters into the condenser here at this particular point, the superheated vapor starts losing its heat to the surroundings, which are maintained at temperature TH. So if I say the temperature T at the exit from the compressor is say 80 degree Celsius and the ambient temperature is let us say 40 degree Celsius. So automatically the heat transfer will take place in the condenser from the superheated refrigerant vapor to the surroundings here. Okay. And at the exit from the condenser, the temperature is lowered. So we can see that the temperature here, it could be 45 degrees Celsius. It is still higher than the atmospheric temperature. And now it is in the liquid form. So here we have the liquid refrigerant and it is still had the high pressure. Then it passes through an expansion device. We have studied about the expansion device or a throttling valve. So in this particular expansion device, the process of throttling takes place. And you know that during the throttling process, the pressure reduces actually. So in the throttling valve or the expansion device, the pressure reduces to that of the evaporator pressure, which is already existing here. Here the pressure in the evaporator is PE. So basically in the expansion device, there is a drop in pressure as well as the temperature. So at point number there is no point. So at this particular location, the pressure is actually PE and the temperature is actually reduced to minus 15 degree Celsius because of the throttling. I have already told you that in the throttling process, the temperature reduces, the pressure reduces. So that is what is happening in case of throttling process. But yes, there is one more thing, that the enthalpy remains constant during this particular process. So you need not to worry. It is just to make you understand how this refrigerator looks like or what are the various components which constitute a refrigerator. So basically the four components are there. One is the evaporator, second is the compressor, third is the condenser, and fourth is the expansion device. Now let us talk about the heat pumping machine. Now what is a heat pumping machine? A heat pump is a device which operating in a cycle maintains a body at a temperature higher than the temperature of the surrounding. So basically I will make the diagram here. So if I say this is the refrigerator and this is the temperature of the products which are cooled at low temperature. Suppose I am considering that the temperature here is minus 25 degrees Celsius. Here in the refrigerator, I am supplying certain amount of the work and this heat is being thrown out to the surroundings, let us say at 25 degrees Celsius. It means that this is a machine which is functioning as a refrigerator. Now दिस रेफ्रिजरेटर इज मेनली रिक्वायर्ड इन समर सीजन, मेनली इन समर सीजन, दो वी आर यूजिंग इट इन विंटर ऑल्सो, बट मेन एप्लीकेशन इज इन दी समर सीजन. नाउ वॉट हैपन्स इन केस ऑफ विंटर्स, एक्चुअली इन केस ऑफ विंटर्स, नाउ सपोज दिस इज द रूम एक्चुअली. ओके, आई एम कंसिडरिंग ए रूम एंड हेयर आई हैव ए हीट पम्प. दिस इज ए हीट पम्प एंड हेयर यू कैन से दिस इज द एम्बियंट टेम्परेचर. दिस इज द एम्बियंट एंड यू नो इन केस ऑफ विंटर्स द एम्बियंट टेम्परेचर गो एज लो एज 4 degrees Celsius. And we want that the room should be maintained at a temperature which is well above the ambient temperature, which is 4 degrees in this particular case. So we would like that the temperature here should be around 24 degrees Celsius. So now only thing is that now in this particular case there is the change in the temperature limits. Okay, and simultaneously in case of the refrigerator, QL is the heat which is to be removed, which is of the which is actually required, which is the energy, that is energy effect sought for. Similarly, in case of a heat pump, the energy effect sought for is QH. So that is the basic difference between a refrigerating machine and a heat pumping machine. So you can see here once again the definition. A heat pump is a device which operating in a cycle maintains a body at a temperature higher than this temperature of the surrounding. So here in place of body, I have considered that we have a room which we are maintaining at around 24 degrees Celsius, and this room can be considered as a body where the temperature is maintained at 24 degrees Celsius, which is actually higher than the ambient temperature. So this is already clear. Now we have a question, which is better, electric heater or a heat pump? So let us try to understand this particular thing. I want to know which is better, a electrical heater or a heat pump. So let us focus here. Here we have shown an electrical heater here. This is the electrical heater. It has a resistance denoted by R, and we are supplying certain amount of the current here. And we know that we can produce certain amount of the heating effect, which is Q, which is equal to I square RT. That is the heating effect. And if I know that the capacity or the power of this electric heater is, let us say, 1 kilowatt, which I have considered here, this is the power of the electrical heater. Okay, so if this is the power, then how much heat I can produce from this electrical heater? If the power is 1 kilowatt and it is the high grade energy, then the equivalent heat produced will be equal to 1000 watts, or I can say it is also equal to 1 kilowatt. So now what is the COP of the electrical heater? If I want to calculate the electrical heater COP, I know it should be equal to energy effect sought for. In case of electrical heater, the energy effect sought for is the heating effect. So equivalent heat produced can be seen said as Q or QH, whatever you want to call it as QH, because we are using in case of heat pump the terminology of QH, which is the energy effect sought for. So simultaneously here also we are using the same, and then divided by the work input. Here instead of work, we are actually inputting the electrical energy, and but that electrical energy can be considered as the work also. And the amount of the electrical energy that is input to the system or to the electrical heater is 1000 kilowatts, and equivalent amount of the heat is produced by the electrical heater. So the COP of electrical heater is 1000 by 1000, and it comes out to be 1. Now let us consider a heat pump. In this particular case, what I am considering here is I am supplying work which is equivalent to 1000 watts only. And now suppose this is the low temperature and this is the high temperature. The low temperature could be say 4 degrees Celsius, and the high temperature could be, let us say, 25 degrees Celsius. Now what I am assuming that when I supply this much amount of the work to the heat pump, I assume that 200 watt of the heat is removed from the surroundings. Actually, this is the surrounding temperature, and what will be delivered to this space here, I can consider that this space is actually a room actually. Now, when it is a room, so I am inputting QH amount of the energy into this room, which is actually equal to W plus QL. The value of W is already known to me. It is 1000 watts, and the heat which is being removed from the low temperature is 200 watts. Yeah, so in total, the total amount of the heat which is being thrown to the room is 1200 watts. So what is the COP of the heat pump? COP of the heat pump is QH divided by W. And what is the value of QH in this particular case? It is 1200, whereas the value of W is 1000. So answer comes out to be 1.2. So it's pretty clear here that the COP of the heat pump will be greater than the COP of the electrical heater. The value of the COP of the heat pump comes out to be 1.2, and this is based on the values which we have considered. Actually, this value could be even greater than 1 also, and the COP of the electrical heater here is 1. So it's clear to you that the heat pump is a better, but yes, there is one of the drawbacks of the heat pump. As you have seen, in case of heat pump, we require 4 components, and those 4 components are evaporator coil, a compressor, a condenser, and an expansion device. And if we and these 4 components are also present in case of a refrigerator, and you know, refrigerator is a costly affair. Sometimes its cost could be as high as rupees 30,000, but if you want a electrical heater, its cost may be very less, somewhere around 200 rupees. Okay, so you can compare both the things cost wise also, and performance parameter wise also. Performance parameter means COP. So cost wise a heat pump is very costly, whereas a electrical heater is very cheap. So whenever we are going to the market and purchasing certain item, we should look for both the things, about the cost as well as the efficiency or the coefficient of the performance of the system. Now, we have studied about Kelvin Planck statement and the Clausius statement of the second law of thermodynamics. So now we are going to understand that both these statements, that is Kelvin Planck statement and Clausius statement, are equivalent to one another. These statements are equivalent to one another. So how? Let us see it here. So first assumption that I have considered is, I would like to violate the Clausius statement, and then I will prove that it also violates the Kelvin Planck statement. So what's written here? Violation of the Clausius statement leads to the violation of the Kelvin Planck statement. So let us focus here on the diagram here on the right hand side. So in the diagram, we have been given a cold reservoir which is at a temperature T2. Let us say this temperature is say minus 10 degrees Celsius. And here we have a heat pump, and here we have hot reservoir, let us say at 40 degrees Celsius. And in this heat pump, the work which we are inputting is actually equal to zero. So when the work is zero, and what we have seen here is, we are withdrawing Q1 amount of the heat from the Q1 amount of the heat from the cold reservoir and throwing it to the hot reservoir at temperature 40 degrees Celsius. So same amount of the heat is withdrawn and same amount of the heat is thrown to the high temperature reservoir without inputting any work or without doing any work on the heat pump. So you know, from the Clausius statement, it is impossible. We cannot transfer heat energy from a body at low temperature to a body at high temperature without the aid of the external work. And in this particular case, the external work is zero. So it is impossible. Now what we can consider is, we assume the same amount of the heat input Q1 from the high temperature T1, high temperature T1 is transferred to a heat engine which produces work W net, which is equal to Q1 minus Q2, and Q2 heat is transferred to the low temperature at temperature T2. So what we have done, basically, whatever is this Q1, this is after it is thrown to the high temperature reservoir at temperature T1, it is once again taken from this high temperature reservoir, and now it is passed through this heat engine. And here the net work is produced, which is equal to Q1 minus Q2. And Q2 is what? Q2 is the amount of the heat which is being thrown to the cold reservoir at temperature of minus 10 degree Celsius, and we are getting W net. Now let us try to understand what will happen if we are doing like this. Now you can focus here. I am drawing a dotted line here. I am considering both these heat engine and the heat pump together. Now I am considering that it is a single system. Now if you will see this single system, what you find that even if we forego this hot reservoir, because what we are doing, we are throwing Q1 amount of the heat into this hot reservoir and taking out the Q1 amount of the heat from this hot reservoir. So basically we don't need this hot reservoir actually. So whatever the heat which is being going out from the heat pump, that is directly fed to the heat engine here. Okay, so this amount is Q1 and the same amount Q1 is fed to the heat engine. Now you see what is actually happening. So when you see this component or this system in totality, now what is happening in this particular case? This system is interacting only with this particular reservoir, which is at low temperature of minus 10 degree Celsius. So it's only a one reservoir. And then what it is doing? It is producing net positive work also. So this is the work which we are getting from it. So this device, this single system is interacting with a single thermal reservoir at low temperature and producing positive work. So as per Kelvin statement, it is impossible to construct a engine which operates in a thermodynamic cycle and produces net positive work while exchanging heat with a single thermal reservoir. So it means you have seen, if the Clausius statement is violated, it also leads to the violation of the Kelvin-Planck statement. Okay, so it means both these statements are equivalent to one another. So in the present scenario, what we have considered? We have considered the violation of the Kelvin-Planck statement, and from there we have proved that the Kelvin-Planck statement is also violated. Now let us change it. Now we are going for the violation of the Kelvin-Planck statement, and from here we will prove that if Kelvin-Planck statement is violated, then the Clausius statement will also be violated. Okay, so a heat engine is considered to be operating with a single thermal reservoir at temperature T1. So you can see it here, we have a high temperature reservoir here which is at temperature T1. We are taking around about Q1 amount of the heat from here and feeding it to the heat engine, and from this heat engine we are getting the work W, because this Q2 is equal to zero, so this W will be equal to Q1. And what we are doing from this Q1? This Q1 is fed to a heat pump here, and this heat pump is taking out the heat Q2 from a low temperature reservoir, and then here we are throwing Q1 plus Q2 to the high temperature reservoir. So I hope this much is clear to you. Once again, I will tell you, we have a heat engine which is interacting with only a single thermal reservoir which is at temperature T1. We are taking out the heat Q1 from this high temperature reservoir, feeding it to the heat engine, and this heat engine is producing work which is equal to Q1 only. So that means no heat is being thrown out of the heat engine to the low temperature reservoir. So it means it's basically violating the Kelvin-Planck statement of the second law of thermodynamics. Now what we are doing from this Q1? This Q1 is actually fed to a heat pump, and you know the function of the heat pump is to take out the heat Q2 from the low temperature reservoir, and it now will be throwing total heat which is equal to Q1 plus Q2, because this is the energy. Q1 is the energy which enters into the heat pump, and Q2 is the energy which enters into the heat pump. So total energy which is leaving is equal to Q1 plus Q2, and it is thrown to the high temperature reservoir. So this is the high temperature reservoir. Now let us try to understand. Now if we consider both systems, that is heat engine and heat pump together, then what will happen? Then the combined system is taking heat Q2 from the low temperature T2. So you can see, we can make a combined system here. So this is the combined system here. Okay, Now, what is happening actually in this particular case? This system is taking heat Q2. Okay. This combined system is taking heat Q2. And because now you see this is an internal affair. This W is equal to Q1. And without the aid of any external work, because this is the boundary now. This is the boundary. So there is no exchange of any work from the outside to the boundary, to the system within the boundary. And what we are doing, we are taking out the Q2 amount of the heat from the low temperature and transferring Q1 plus Q2 amount of the heat to the high temperature reservoir. So effectively, if you see, and then what we are doing, we are taking out heat Q1 from this high temperature reservoir. So in effect, what we could have done, Q1 amount of the heat is taken directly from here. Okay. And only Q2 amount of the heat goes continuously to the high temperature reservoir. So effectively, you can see that we are transferring the energy Q2 from the low temperature reservoir to the high temperature reservoir without the aid of any external work. Because this is the system now. This is a system and there is no work transfer to this system actually. So it means if we violate the Kelvin-Planck statement, it also violates the Clausius statement. So it means both these statements are equivalent to one another. Now let us talk a little bit about the reversible and irreversible processes. Based on the second law of thermodynamics, we can divide all processes in two ways. The first one is the reversible or ideal processes, and the second one is the irreversible or natural processes. Now, what is a reversible process? A reversible process is one which is performed in such a way that at the conclusion of the process, both the system and the surroundings may be restored to their initial states without producing any changes in the rest of the universe. For example, now let us try to understand it from here. Suppose initially the system is at state point A, it follows this particular path and reaches to point number B. And during this process, let us say the heat QAB enters into the system, and simultaneously from the system we get certain amount of the work which is equal to WA2B. So these are the energy interaction with the surroundings. Now what we do, we reverse this process. Now the process is taking place from B towards A, and the system once again reaches to point A, and let us apply this amount of the work which is equal to WB2A, such that WB2A is equal to W from A to B. Means if this work was equal to 50 kilojoules, if it was positive, then here this work is minus 50 kilojoules, which is being supplied to the system. Because it is being supplied from the surroundings to the system, we are considering it to be negative. So in effect, the total work is zero. And simultaneously, when the system is moving from B to A, and we have heat is transferred, which is equal to QB to A, and the value of QA to B is equal to QB to A. So if it is like this, then what you will see that the system has undergone a process from A to B, first of all. Then we will say that 50 kilojoule, if I say that 30 kilojoule of heat enters into it, and 50 kilojoule of the work is done by the system. And then from B to A, when the system moves, then minus 50 kilojoule of the work is done and minus 30 kilojoule of the heat goes out. So this was the heat from A to B. This was the work from A to B. And this is the heat from B to A. And this is the work from B to A. So you can see, what is the net effect in the surroundings? You will find that there is no net effect in the surrounding. So a reversible process should not leave any trace or relic to show that the process has ever occurred. So what is happening in this particular case also? You have seen there is no energy interaction which is actually remaining with the surrounding. So the net effect is there is no heat transfer and there is no work transfer. from the system to the surroundings or from the surrounding to the system. So such a process is actually a reversible process. A reversible process is carried out infinitely slowly with an infinitesimal gradient, so that every state passed through by the system is an equilibrium state. So a reversible process coincides with a quasi-static process. Okay, so this is what is known as the reversible process. Now, what is an irreversible process? Any natural process carried out with a finite gradient is an irreversible process. A reversible process, which consists of a succession of equilibrium states, is an idealized hypothetical process approached only as a limit. It is said to be an asymptote to reality. Means a reversible process cannot happen in reality actually. But all spontaneous processes are irreversible. So in case of a real system, there would always be irreversible process. We can try to approach the reversibility, but it's very difficult to get a reversible, impossible to rather get a reversible process. So once again, to make you understand, all reversible processes are impossible processes. All processes which occur in nature are irreversible processes. The irreversibility of a process may be due to one of the following. So here we are going to read about the causes of irreversibility. So you need not to go into the depth, only you need to just remember these things. The first one is the lack of the equilibrium during the process. It leads to the irreversibility, involvement of the dissipative effects. So let us see, what is the meaning of the irreversibility due to lack of equilibrium? Lack of equilibrium means, for example, if there is heat transfer through a finite temperature difference, then it is a sort of irreversible process. And you know, we always require some temperature difference or temperature gradient for heat transfer to take place. And it is basically causing a process to become irreversible. Similarly, lack of pressure equilibrium within the interior of the system or between the system and the surroundings also leads, also makes a process irreversible. And if it is a free expansion process, that is also irreversible in nature. Now, what is the meaning of irreversibility due to dissipative effects? For example, one of the examples is friction. Friction makes a process irreversible. It is a sort of dissipation of the energy. If we have two surfaces which are in close contact with each other, then the motion of the one object over the other will be creating the friction between the two bodies, and this some part of that energy or the kinetic energy will be dissipated as friction. Similarly, if you talk of the pedal wheel work transfer, you remember we talked about the pedal wheel work transfer. There was a closed container and there was a pedal here, and there was a churning action which is taking place within the fluid and the pedal here. This was the pedal actually. Okay, so here also once again the friction comes into picture, and that is why we call that pedal wheel work transfer is a dissipative effect, and it causes the process to become irreversible. The third is the transfer of the electricity through a resistor. It also makes the process irreversible. So you need not to go into the detail, but you should only remember that there can be irreversibility due to lack of equilibrium, and there can be irreversibility due to dissipative effects. Now, friction and perpetual motion machine of third kind. Friction is always present in moving devices. Friction may be reduced by suitable lubrication, but it can never be completely eliminated. If this were possible, a movable device could be kept in continual motion without violating either of the two laws of the thermodynamics. So what is a PMM3 actually? So what does this statement actually means? See, if we have a machine and if there is no friction in it, then it will be continuously giving out us the work if we set it into motion once. Because if there is no friction, the machine will keep on running and keep on giving us the work. So that is how it will happen. But you know, there is friction and it cannot give us work continuously. So the continual motion of a movable device in the complete absence of friction is known as perpetual motion machine of the third kind or PMM 3. So if there is no friction, then such a machine will be known as perpetual motion machine of the third kind. So basically, if there are no dissipative effects in that particular machine, that will become a PMM 3. Now, what are the conditions for the reversibility? Basically, we said there are two reasons for the irreversibility. One is the lack of the equilibrium, and second is the presence of the dissipative effects. So basically, whatever is written here, it basically deals with that if we can remove these two things. One is the dissipative effects. One is the dissipative effects, and the second is the means lack of equilibrium. Lack of equilibrium. If somehow we can make the process to take place without these two things, then that process will become a reversible process. So basically, a natural process is irreversible because the conditions of the mechanical, thermal and chemical equilibrium are not satisfied, and the dissipative effects in which the work is transformed into an increase in the internal energy are present. A process will be reversible when it is performed in such a way that the system is at all times infinitesimally near a state of thermodynamic equilibrium and in the absence of the dissipative effects of any form. Reversible processes are therefore purely ideal limiting cases of actual process. So basically it means if it's an actual process, then it can never be a reversible process. Only an ideal process can be considered as a reversible process. And you know, in case of reversible process, it has to be performed quasi-statically. The system should pass through thermodynamic equilibrium states, which may be traversed only in one direction as in the opposite direction. So both in the reversible process can take place in both the direction. Okay, we have discussed about it. So this is something about conditions of reversibility. So once again, to remind you, there should not be any dissipative effects and there should not be any lack of equilibrium. If these two things are absent, then the process will become a reversible process. Now, till now we have talked about the Clausius statements, equivalence of the Clausius statement with the Kelvin-Planck statement, and then we discussed about the reversible process, irreversible process, conditions of reversibility, and how to make a process reversible. This is what we have studied till now. We also discussed about the working of a refrigerator and a heat pump. So now I am going to the next topic, very, very important topic. It's the Carnot heat engine and a Carnot cycle actually. When we talk about Carnot heat engine or Carnot cycle, it's basically a reversible heat engine. Okay, it's a reversible heat engine, and Carnot cycle is always considered as a reversible cycle. Now, what has been shown here is, I think you might have studied this Carnot cycle earlier also. It comprises of the four processes. Two are reversible isothermal, and two processes are reversible adiabatics. So basically, there are four processes. Two are reversible isothermals and two are reversible adiabatics. A Carnot heat engine is shown in the diagram. So this is the diagram which is shown here. What has been shown here is it is in the form of a cylinder piston. It's basically a closed system and contains a gas and is insulated from all sides except its head. You can see here, this is actually insulation. Here also it is insulated here. This is the cylinder part, and here we have the piston, and there is a gas here, and its head, there is a diathermic wall. Diathermic wall is, or diathermic cover means the heat transfer through it can take place, and we also have a adiabatic cover B. So, and we have two reservoir is also, one is at temperature T1, we are designating it as source, and other is sink, which is at temperature T2. Rather than T2, we will call it as TL, which is the sink temperature, and source temperature we will call it as TH. Similarly, Q1 we are calling as QH, and Q2 we are calling as QL. So let us see how it works actually. Now let us read it here. The head can be made either adiabatic or diathermic using two covers, that is cover A, which is diathermic, that is across which the heat can flow, and cover B, which is adiabatic in nature, that is it does not allow heat to flow through it. The Carnot engine undergoes a reversible cycle comprising of the following four processes. Now let us see what are these four processes. The first process is process 1-2. It is the isothermal heat addition QH at high temperature TH. So let us see how it is taking place. So initially what we have considered here is we have this is the source temperature TH, and there is a diathermic cover which is placed on the head. This is the head actually of the engine. So there is a diathermic cover, and we bring this head in contact with this source actually. So heat QH flows into the gas here, and the system moves from point number one here to point number two, and this process is actually reversible isothermal, or it takes place at constant temperature. So basically it means if the temperature of the source here is TH, then the temperature of the gas here is also TH. So there is no temperature difference. So the heat is being transferred from the source to the gas at the same temperature TH, and this heat transfer is actually equal to QH. Now what happens when this gas is expanding from state point 1 to state point 2, suddenly what we do is we replace this diathermic cover with this adiabatic cover. Now further expansion takes place as a reversible adiabatic process, okay, as a reversible adiabatic process from point number 2 to point number 3. This is the process which is taking place in a reversible adiabatic manner. So some internal energy of the gas is utilized to give out the work WE, which is the expansion work during this particular process. As you know, during a reversible adiabatic process, there is no heat transfer. So the internal energy of the gas is utilized for expanding the gas from state point 2 to state point 3. So the volume increases from V2 to V3 actually. Now what happens once again? So you can see here, process 2 to 3 is what? It is the reversible adiabatic expansion of the gas up to temperature TL and volume V3. So one thing is important to note here. Point number one, the temperature is TH. Point number two, once again, the temperature is TH, because it's a reversible isothermal process. And during the process 2 to 3, temperature at point 2 is TH, whereas the temperature at point 3 is TL. This is the temperature TL. So it is the system reaches to the lower temperature TL. Okay. That is the temperature of the sink here, and TH was the temperature of the source here. Now what happens actually at when the system has already reached up to point number 3? Now what we do, once again this diathermic cover is brought in contact, and this adiabatic cover is removed. Now so what will happen, the system will start transferring heat from the temperature TL to this sink, which is also maintained at temperature TL. And when the heat is transferred from the system to the surroundings, the volume will decrease from V3 to V4 at the constant temperature. And this constant temperature is TL. So here, if this is temperature TL, then this temperature is also TL. And during the process 3 to 4, the whole temperature is TL. And during this process, heat is going out from the system, or out from the gas actually. So process 3 to 4 is isothermal heat rejection QL at low temperature TL. The diathermic cover A is in communication with the sink at TL. The volume changes from V3 to V4. Now what happens during the process 4 to 1? Now what we will do, we remove this diathermic cover. This cover is actually removed now at point number 4 here. And this adiabatic cover B is brought in contact with the head. So once the adiabatic cover is there, so no heat loss can take place to the surrounding. So what happens there? Automatically, the compression of the gas takes place from point number 4 to point number 1. And it completes the cycle also. And the system reaches to temperature TH at state point 1. So this is how this cycle is taking place. This is actually a larger diagram. You can see process 1 to 2, the temperature TH is constant. Process 3 to 4, temperature TL is constant. If you see this particular process, you can see it's a reversible adiabatic process. And during this process, PV raised to power gamma is equal to constant. And the process 4 to 1, this is also a reversible adiabatic process. It's shown here also. So during this process also, we can say that PV raised to power gamma is equal to constant. So these are the various relationships. And this heat which is being transferred from the process in the process 1 to 2 is QH, and the heat which is lost to the surrounding during the process 3 to 4 is QL. Okay. So now we have we are going to write the various heat transfer terms. The first is the Q1 to 2, or heat transfer during the process 1 to 2. Now, if you remember the equation of the heat transfer, it is equal to P1 V1 log natural V2 by V1. And if you see the process 2 to 3 is a reversible adiabatic process. So in this particular case, the value of heat transfer will be 0. Similarly, process 3 to 4, if we talk about it, then it is a reversible isothermal process. And in this particular case, the heat transfer is given by P3 V3 log natural V4 by V3. During the process 4 to 1, it is equal to heat transfer is equal to 0, being it's a adiabatic process. Now you can see we have four processes in which the system is undergoing a thermodynamic cycle. So we can apply the first law of thermodynamics for the thermodynamic cycle, and we can say that cyclic integral of delta W is equal to cyclic integral of delta Q. And this cyclic integral of delta W can be written as W net, and here delta Q cyclic can be written as Q1 to 2 plus Q2 to 3 plus Q3 to 4 plus Q4 to 1. And you know that this Q2 to 3 is 0 because it's an adiabatic process. Q4 to 1 is also equal to 0 because once again it's an adiabatic process. So we can say that W net is equal to Q1 to 2 plus Q3 to 4. Okay. Because during 2 to 3 and 4 to 1 being the adiabatic processes, the value is 0 for the heat transfer. So now once again, we have written this P1 V1 log V2 by V1 and plus P3 V3 log V4 by V3. And you should always remember this diagram here, PV diagram, which is drawn something like this. Okay. Here this is 1, 2, 3, 4. So here the volume is I will redraw it. I will erase it, otherwise it will create confusion in your mind. So you can draw it easily like this. So this is 1. This is 1. This is 2. This is 3, this is 4. So this is how the cycle is going on. It is a clockwise cycle. So clockwise cycles are always heat engine cycles. Very, very important to remember this. Clockwise cycles are heat engine cycles. So you can see in this diagram that V2 is greater than V1. You can see it here. This is V2. This is greater than V1. Okay. So this is a positive quantity. If you see V3 and V4, V4 is here and V3 is here. So this ratio is actually less than 1. So it's a negative term. So effectively, if you see q1 to 2 and q3 to 4 these are showing the heat transfers during the process 1 to 2 and 3 to 4, but only their signs can tell us in which direction the heat transfer is taking place. Because the value of q1 to 2 is coming out to be positive, it is heat which is being added into the system. So it's a sort of heat supplied to the system. Whereas if you see the sign of the q3 to 4, it is the heat rejected because it is negative. Okay, if you will see its sign, it comes out to be negative. So it's heat rejected by the system. So we can easily write this quantity W net as heat supplied minus heat rejected in terms of heat supplied and heat rejected. And you know, this heat supplied is QH and heat rejected is given as QL. So you should remember this diagram. It is very, very simple to understand it. This is the heat engine here. This is the reversible heat engine. Okay. It is taking heat QH from the temperature TH, and QL amount of the heat is thrown out, and W net is being produced here. Okay. So once again, we can write it as QH minus QL. Okay. So now, what is the efficiency of the reversible heat engine? RHE stands for the reversible heat engine. It is equal to W net divided by the heat supplied. W net is equal to QH minus QL, and heat supplied is QH. So here we get 1 minus QL over QH. And then we can put the values of QL and QH. So 1. Now, what is the value of QL? This is the value of QL. This is rather the value of Q3 to 4, which is equal to minus QL. So QL will be equal to P3 V3 log natural V3 by V4. Okay. And in the denominator, we have P1 V1 log natural V2 by V1. This is the value of QH or Q1 to 2. So finally, you can see, we can also say that P3 V3 is equal to MRTL, because this is the gas equation. MRT is equal to P into V, or PV is equal to MRT. Similarly, P1 V1 can be written as MRTH. So finally, we can say MR and MR will cancel out from the denominator and the numerator, and we are left with 1 minus TL over TH log of V3 by V4 divided by log of V2 by V1. This is what is left to us. So what we can do now is, we can this is once again the efficiency. Now what we can do is, we can go look for the process 2 to 3. What is process 2 to 3 here? This is a reversible adiabatic process, and in case of a reversible adiabatic process, we know that PV raised to power gamma minus 1 is equal to constant, and we can write T2 V2 raised to power gamma minus 1 is equal to T3 V3 raised to power gamma minus 1. If you see, what is T2? T2 is nothing but TH. T1 is TH. T3 is TL. T4 is TL. Because this process from 1 to 2 is at constant temperature, constant high temperature, whereas the process 3 to 4 is taking place at low temperature TL. So T2 is replaced here by TH, and T3 is replaced here by TL. So I can say that TH by TL is equal to V3 by V2 raised to power gamma minus 1. Let us call this as the equation 1. Similarly, if we take the process 4 to 1, we can write T4 V4 raised to power gamma minus 1 is equal to T1 V1 raised to power gamma minus 1. Or, as I told you, TH, T1 is TH. T4 is TL. So I can write TH by TL is equal to V4 by V1 raised to power gamma minus 1. And this is equation number 2. If you see both these equations, the left hand side is TH by TL, TH by TL. So right hand side should also be equal. So we can say that V3 by V2, this term, V3 by V2 raised to power gamma minus 1 should be equal to V4 by V1 raised to power gamma minus 1. Because both are having the same powers, this will cancel out and we will be left with V3 by V2 is equal to V4 by V1. Then we can rearrange these terms and can say that V3 by V4 is equal to V2 by V1. And if we take log on both the sides, we will get log V3 by V4 is equal to log V2 by V1. So you see this equation now, this equation. this is what, this is log v3 by v4, log v3 by v4 here, and log v2 by v1, it is equal to log v2 by v1. So this term will cancel out, this cancels out, and we are left with efficiency of the reversible heat engine is equal to 1 minus TL over TH. So it means efficiency of the Carnot cycle is equal to 1 minus TL over TH, where TL is the lower temperature and TH is the higher temperature. So I hope that this much is sufficient for today. You can see this lecture, and if you have any problem, you can ask me.